One thing I really adore about this movie is the costumes. They're also very reflective of everybody's personalities. I was wondering if you guys can just talk about, you know, getting into that costume and how that helped you shape your role.
Wardrobe is always a huge part. You know, it's like a part of the rehearsal process and finding out who you are. This was a very, very collaborative one, and it was very, very helpful for me. Once I put on some of those shirts and those pants, and the pants were really high, and that chain wallet, you know, you start walking around like that, and you start kind of feeling the character. So it was extremely helpful.
I literally bought a wallet chain for my husband for Christmas.
You did?
Because of your costume.
Oh, that's amazing.
I keep trying. I'm like, it looked so cool when Chris wore it. And he was like, I'm not wearing this. I was like,
I'll take it.
Fashion, babe.
Well, one thing that comic book fans are really going to love is bringing in the roller skate aspect of Harley. What was it like to get on skates and do the roller derby and bring that into the action late in the film, too?
I very much underestimated how difficult it would be. I thought, I did Tonya, like, how it's going to be way easier than ice skating. And it was less painful than ice skating, but it was different and very difficult. And we added elements like a moving carousel and, you know, moving cars, and that definitely added a level of difficulty. And I loved it, but yeah, it was tricky. But no, as a fellow comic book fan, that image of Harley and skates is so iconic to me. I was like, it has to be in the movie. I remember so many times in the script development process, people, you know, you look for the parts, like, budgetary wise, like, what don't we need? What can we cut out? And everyone kept being like, we do not need a roller derby in this movie. And I was like, yes, we do. We'll make it pay off in the end. She can get back in the skates. Please, I have to have a roller derby.
Fans will appreciate that. Yeah. I think everyone's going to appreciate that. One thing that also, speaking of budget, I know this couldn't have been easy to pull off the hyena. I mean, that's a big ask. And you guys pulled that off. You two both had scenes with the hyena. What was that like on set? What were you working with? What, like, how did you do it?
It was. I mean, it was one of those things that when we first put in the script, Christina and I, because obviously in the comics, Harley has two hyenas. Ultimately, we have one because even one was expensive. But we thought it was a great idea at the time, and then in pre-production, suddenly everyone's like, "So how are we doing the hyena thing? It's incredibly difficult." We went to go see a real-life hyena. There's a hyena in California that's appeared on screen before. Turns out it was going to be impossible to shoot with him because they're extremely dangerous and take ownership of anything they touch. So if you put it on a couch, then it's going to eat the couch. You can't get the couch back. Doesn't really work for filming. So ultimately, we had a really big dog. That was then, its fur was CGI'd and body shape CGI'd to look like a hyena. Because the alternative is to have, you know, a dude in a green suit. And that's often weird. I've seen that process play out when we did Tarzan. I remember watching Alex Skarsgård like nuzzling with like this big, big burly dude from South London. And I was just like, It's weird. It doesn't feel as authentic.
Sharing a Twizzler with a dude in a big green suit. Yeah, a little weird too.
So I shared a Twizzler with a big dog instead.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah.
I loved the aspect of the fourth wall breaking Harley, almost a little bit of like what we've seen in like Deadpool, but you put your own spin on that. Where did that come? Where did the idea for this Harley that can be part of the movie but also acknowledge that people are watching it and hearing this story? Where'd that come from?
I think it came from just the rebellious nature of what she would be like as a storyteller. We didn't want to kind of commit to any of the traditional storyteller rules. She wouldn't tell a story the way someone else would. It would be out of order. She forgets to introduce you to people. She takes you back in time. She explains things in her way with her point of view as opposed to what you're actually seeing on camera. So it's just another one of those devices that I think that... Yeah, it gives that rebellious nature as your unreliable narrator.
I totally know a few people who are going to be like, oh my God, that's me when I tell a story. I go this way or that way.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Chris, your Zaz was evil as hell.
Cool.
Creepy, but you did such a good job playing that.
Thanks, man.
Can you talk to me about, like, you know, what kind of direction Kathy gave you and how much of that is your own, just bringing that to life?
Yeah, it was a little bit of everything. You know, the script was, it had some beautiful writing in it, and Kathy, we did some rehearsals and we played around a bit, and the comic books were also really, really helpful. You know, I've said this a few times that Zaz is kind of low in the canon of villains, and I found like a real responsibility to try to give him a voice, try to do something different with him. I saw Anthony Carrigan do it on on, is it, what's that show called? Gotham? Is it called Gotham?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Fox.
Yeah, and he was great. And I just wanted to, you know, I just wanted to try to find a Zaz that would maybe take over one day and be the master of the universe.
You did a great job.
Thanks, man.
And Ellie, you're playing Cassandra Cain. So I'm curious, when you get that role, do you immediately know, you know, the history of Cassandra Cain in comics and who she becomes? Are you familiar with that? Did you research and find out? And what's your reaction?
I actually didn't know in the beginning who Cassandra Cain was, and I wasn't even pitched at a. It wasn't even pitched to me as Cassandra Cain, and then I really looked into the comics and what her origin story was, and I took some stuff off of The Professional with Natalie Portman and that sort of vulnerable, scrappy kid, and there hasn't really been any Cassandra Cain in any film, so I really base it off of like a vulnerable kid and a lot of the comics that really helped
too. And Margie, you're finding a whole new stride with Harley. I mean, we loved her in Suicide Squad. She takes it to a whole other level in this one. I mean, we get more violence, we get more language and just more freedom, I think. And of course, we're always looking forward to what's next. Does this kind of continue with James Gunn and what he's telling you to do on the Suicide Squad?
Yeah, no, exactly. Again, you get to see another side of Harley, and it's kind of interesting. You keep getting to meet her at different points in her life as if a couple of years have gone by. Of course, the films aren't directly connected, but as an actor, I can map it out in a chronological sense. So it's fun to see her. Okay, what was she like a couple of years ago when she was with Mr. J? Okay, what's she like now after they've broken up, and what's she going to be like in another couple of years' time? I love seeing her at these different stages of her life.
That's going to be cool. And yeah. James made the jump from Marvel to DC.
Yeah.
Are you allowed to make the jump from DC to Marvel?
I'm not allowed.
Oh, okay. Have you thought about that?
I don't know if I could.
Because I could think of a few.
Who? Tell me. What would you?
Sue Storm, Clea in Doctor Strange, Sue Storm in the Fantastic Four. I could see any of those.
Wow.
Oh, nice.
I don't know.
Maybe we'll see one day. For now, I'm happy with Birds of Prey. The movie was super fun.
Yeah, nice. I mean, Harley keeps my hands full, to be honest. I don't know how I would manage.
I bet.